shits.
And now, the six merry murderesses of the Cook County Jail in their rendition of the Cell Block Tango.
And welcome to Book versus Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of ColoniaBook.com, and this is my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone.
We are approaching the middle of March. For those of you who are new to Book versus Movie, we do all musicals in March. Over the years, we've been at this almost 8 years. Over the years, we've started doing kind of theme months, which is sort of fun. Everybody kind of gets involved in it. And we are smack dab in the middle of musical month. And I'm very excited to talk about today's musical. I know you are too. But if you're new, there's a few things you should know. Number one, we're playing a little fast and loose with the word book these days because we are doing, you know, because of the pandemic situation, we decided we have committed to doing a brand new episode every single week. And so that means, you know, we can't read a giant tome. I was looking at, I think it was The King and I. It's a massive book.
Oh, yeah. There's quite a few. Yeah, that we would love
to
do.
So we won't be doing that.
Yeah.
So anyway, we're choosing shorter literary sources, whether it's a play or a novella or a magazine article or a newspaper article, literally any literary source. So that's why we're doing a play, although this one has multiple literary sources, which is kind of fun. And we'll get into that in a minute. But if you would like to make suggestions for books and movies or, you know, other sources and movies, or if you want to interact with us and other listeners of this podcast, there's several places where you can do that on the internet.
So we do have a basic Facebook page. Be sure to like it. We also have a private Facebook group, and that's really a great place to send us suggestions. We've been getting lots of people joining the group lately. I don't know if you've noticed, Margo, but keep them coming. Keep joining us. It's Book vs. Movie Podcast Group. On Twitter and Instagram, we're at Book versus a Movie. You just spell it all out. You can also send suggestions there. Be sure to like it there if you like those spaces. We also have just a basic old-timey email, bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. And if you would like some stickers or you would like a magnet, we will drop them in the mail for you. So just send us a note. And that's also another place where you could leave us your suggestions. We just ask that the source be something that we can easily get. It needs to be a book that's either, you know, on the Libby app or it's on Kindle. It's pretty easy to get. And the movie needs to be streaming. If we can't find the movie anywhere, there's just no point. So just remember that when you're coming up with ideas for us.
Yes, thank you for mentioning that. It has to be something that everybody can get. Please do join the Facebook group. It is, we promise, it is a happy little haven in the toilet bowl that is Facebook. we really, seriously, it's, you will not be disappointed. But if you really, really like the show and you want to help keep us in books and movies, you could also support us on Patreon.
We do have a new Patreon member. Her name is Kate. Thank you so much, Kate, for joining. We are taking all of our episodes starting early March 2020, and then previous to that, they're all going up on there. There's about 80 episodes up there. If you would like to just check it out, there are quite a few that are free, like some of the holiday episodes, because we aired those a few times, that kind of thing. But go check it out. Patreon, P-A-T-R-E-O-N. We have monthly options. And Margo, we've actually had a couple of listeners approach us to say that Patreon now offers a yearly option, which means you just pay the one time. that's something you would all be interested in, let us know in the Facebook group or send us an email or whatever, and we will be sure to set that up. And it starts at the first of the month. So April Fool's Day, we'll get started on that if you're interested.
Only we'll be serious about it.
We will be very serious about it. That's how we are.
Well, after last week's episode, which took us to places we did not even imagine that we would go, I sort of thought things would settle down this week and that we'd have like a good old traditional, it was a play, it was, and they turned it into a movie. Nope. Once again, we are going to get an extraordinary story from our source author,
Maureen Dallas Watkins.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah.
Buckle up, folks.
She's an Indiana. Well, she's actually originally from Kentucky, but she considers herself a person that's from Indiana. That's where she mainly grew up. She was a playwright and a screenwriter. But before that, she was a writer, and she wrote for the Chicago Tribune at their crime desk, and they were looking for sob sisters. These were women who had reporters, lady reporters, can you imagine that? Who, and her beat was everything that was happening in crime in Chicago. And mainly, it's 1896 when she was born. It's about the 1920s when she was there. It's jazz music. There's a prohibition in America. We've talked about this time period before. America gets out of World War I. We get over a flu. America kind of has this, you know, it's the jazz era. Mores are changing and sexuality is becoming more to the fore. And so she's writing about these women that murdered their boyfriends and husbands and associated louses, as they were called. She interviewed them. Some of these women became really famous for their man getting eyes or man, the way she described these women, they were just beautiful. And then the public would feel sorry for them. And a few women were let off on murder charges. She writes this story. She's one of the first people to attend Yale's drama school. Excuse me. She's one of the first people to help start that. She wrote her play there, and the play was eventually became Chicago. And then that play was started in 1926 on Broadway, did pretty well. And then she went to Hollywood, and she's been in a bunch of screenplays, and she's written a bunch of plays. Never got married, never had kids. Apparently later in her life, she became a born-again Christian, and so she went against she would not sell this material. A lot of people wanted to take Chicago and make a musical out of it or just make a movie out of it. And she was absolutely no way until she dies 1969. And that's when it gets sold to Gwen Verdon and Bob Fosse and their partners. And so this original piece, all the main characters are there, but I loved this book though. I thought this was really fun.
It's phenomenal. So just so people know, can you talk a little bit about the book that we read?
Well, so you and I have two different copies.
Oh, do we?
Yes, I didn't realize that.
Oh. But,
so I have a first edition, Margot, 1927.
Wow.
Chicago book. And it's the original with the notes in it. What Margot has, and now this book is hard to get. We are admitting this. We got these a few months ago because we really, really wanted to do this episode. So Margot's, when was it published? I want to say around when the movie came out. That would make the most sense.
It is around when the movie came out. Yes, it came out. Actually, no, it came out in 1997.
Oh, okay.
And it's called Chicago, the Story Behind the Broadway Smash Hit. So my edition has the original script, and it also has a foreword with some background about Maureen Watkins. And then at the back of the book, it has all of the actual bylines that she had covering these actual stories. You can see line by line, words of dialogue and words of direction that are in the play. I want to talk a little bit about, in looking at Maureen Watkins, her education is very, very interesting. So she goes to school, and then she goes to Chicago to be a reporter, and then she comes back to school. Both times she's under the tutelage of a gentleman by the name of George Pierce Baker, mm-hmm. who ran the Harvard and then later the Yale drama programs. These are some of the people that George Baker helped bring up as writers. Philip Barry, Edward Shelton, Thomas Wolfe, not Tom Wolfe of Bonfire of the Vanities, no. But Thomas Wolfe of Look Homeward, Angel, and You Can't Go Home Again. And a young lad named Eugene O'Neill. Perhaps you've heard of him.
Wow.
So, yeah, he was a huge deal. And kind of I saw this really interesting, and I'll post it in the Facebook group. It's literally from a few days ago. A dramaturg made a presentation about Maurine Watkins, I think to the Yale, I think to that same program.
Oh, interesting.
And yeah. And by the way, Maurine Watkins was not the only woman accepted into that program. And there were some questions about that. Apparently, Mr. Baker, it was probably the most equitable education program at either of these universities at the time. We had people of color, he had women, and he was extremely progressive in his, in his teaching and also in who he would accept into his program. And it's believed that at some point he said to Maureen, go out and get some experience, kid, and then come back, kind of thing. And then happily took her back when she wanted to come back and start writing. And she is just a brilliant writer. I mean, the script of the original, and there's some differences, but there are sure a lot of similarities.
They were mining really good material. Like we said, she was in the jailhouse talking to these women, and years later, she felt guilty about it. Like she knew that when people wanted to make a Broadway show, that what they were going to do with it. But we have Beulah Annan. She became, is that how you pronounce her name? She
was, I think so. Beulah Annan, who is the real woman. That's right. Her real name. This is the real story. Who is fictionalized as Roxy Hart, right?
Right. And then we have Belva Gaertner, who became mm-hmm. Velma. And mm-hmm. there were two different lawyers, William Scott Stewart and W.W. O'Brien. And then she turned them into Billy Flynn. Mary Sunshine, who's the reporter who, just has to put a nice sheen on all of these stories. She's sort of like a goof on women reporters that male reporters would think of a woman reporter. Somebody super empathetic and looking for that. And like I said, this play comes out. It does really well. And it actually performed around the country. And Clark Gable was in a production.
It was super successful.
Yeah.
Yeah. People loved it.
They did. And she moved. And if you look at her IMDb page, there's a lot of successful movies. And she did really well. She did the thing, though, that she was happy with it, but she didn't really love it. She made enough money from Chicago that she had $1 million in like the 30s.
She
very
was,
wealthy.
Yeah. Very wealthy.
And so she traveled and she loved to travel. So and she, single woman, never married, never had kids. She was a bit of a recluse later in her life. Like I said before, didn't want to. She became a born-again Christian. She also developed cancer, and I read one place it was lung cancer, then someplace else that actually it was throat or face cancer, and she was very self-conscious of her appearance, so she was just a recluse. She would stay home and wear like a scarf around her head when she went out. But the Fosse's...
Because again, this is the 60s.
Yes, of course.
This is not an advanced time in cancer treatment.
No, that's when my grandparents both died of cancer, and it was like you went into the hospital for a gallbladder operation, and then it was just downhill. And that's what happened with her. Now, Fosse and Verdon were married late 50s, early 60s.
I believe so.
And he really tried to, this is like his present for her because Gwen really, really, really wanted to do. And we talked about them when we talked about Cabaret last year. And there's the Fosse Verdon, I think it's on Amazon. You could stream that on Amazon, I believe,
it's
right now.
It's brilliant.
It's
so good.
It's brilliant. And it really talks about how this show comes about. So that was the play. I didn't see the movie, the 1927 movie. I think you put the link in the...
I did. It was very interesting. So there was a, and I think D.W. Griffith produced it. Mm. So there was a, the presentation, and I'll share it in the Facebook group. So the woman who was giving the lecture, the dramaturg, about Maurine Watkins was saying that one of the things about Maurine Watkins is certainly in her early life, she had just incredible luck. I mean, mm-hmm. she was very talented and extremely industrious, you can clearly, but also, she had these amazing turns of luck. First of all, that she crossed paths with this Professor Baker, right, who encouraged her. The beat that she got in Chicago, she got a lot of lucky journalistic breaks. And one of the breaks that she got with the play was that the person who the producers had cast as Roxy, she didn't really like. She wanted this other person named Lattimore or something like that. Anyway, late on, that woman dropped out. She had to drop out. And so she got the actor she wanted, who made this play a smash success. It's so interesting to read these articles. But the silent movie. Yeah, so then it gets picked up to be a movie. Like, it's still on the stage and it gets picked up to be a movie produced by D.W. Griffith. I mean, huge deal. She doesn't have, I couldn't tell how much a hand she had in the adaptation. Unfortunately, it's a silent movie. So, you know, one of the great things about the stage play is this zippy dialogue, mm-hmm. you know, this snappy, you know, real lifted right out of the headlines dialogue, which in a silent movie, you're only getting, you know, a tiny fraction of it in these little cards, you know, every now and again. And so the story doesn't have the kind of zippy, you know, vivaciousness. It's a lot more melodramatic and heavy. And I think really just because of that, it's just because it's a silent movie, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. I can't say it's poorly acted or poorly directed. It's just we don't have that lovely dialogue that's keeping things bubbling along. But it's cool. It's cool to see like a, you know, it's from the 20s. So it is a contemporary portrayal of this story. You know, not only is it right after the play came out, it's while like the living people who inspired these characters are still alive.
Right.
So, and still quite young and probably wreaking havoc of another kind. So yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty good.
We go.
No, then there's the Ginger Rogers one.
Right. And I didn't see that one either.
Which is not very good.
Okay.
I saw a little bit of it. It is not good. It's really weird. For one thing, I mean, I'll just give you a little, and by the way, we spoil everything.
Yes.
In case you didn't know, if you're new and you don't like spoilers, sorry in advance. But the Ginger Rogers is just called Roxy Hart. And it seems like Maureen Watkins had some kind of a hand in the production. She does get some kind of a credit for that. But spoiler alert, in that version, if I remember correctly, it is Roxy's husband who kills the boyfriend.
Right.
And
that would have been the Hays code.
Roxy, yeah. And Roxy goes to jail, you know, because she loves to stand by her man. So she goes to jail for a crime that he committed. And I'm not even sure that the boyfriend is a boyfriend. It's really schlocky. It's not good.
The Hays code made it so that a lot of really fun stories weren't told properly because the bad person couldn't get away with it. And they certainly don't want to see a nice woman like Ginger Rogers be mean and be a killer.
No.
Maybe that would be part of it.
I'm sure that's a big part of it.
Yeah. Of course, I didn't see the musical on Broadway. I was little in 1975 when this came out. But I remember it was very, very popular. My parents went to see it. And I remember the commercial for it. I love Broadway commercials.
I do too. Oh, they're so fun.
They're really ridiculously fun.
Remember Cats with like the fog machine?
And then they had the one where, have you seen it six times yet? All these people did. Like, it's people who sing it over and over again. I remember Chicago because it was like these, it was very scantily clad. These are itsy bitsy little outfits.
Even for then.
Even for 70s, it's like,
it's quite racy.
It's extremely racy. So like a part of you is like, ooh, what are the adults, you know, into?
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm gonna rouge my knees and roll my stockings down. And all that jazz, start the car. I know a whoopee spot where the gin is cold, but the piano's hot. Oh, you're gonna see your Sheba shimmy shake. And all that jazz. Oh, she's gonna shimmy till her daughters break.
Chicago, starring Gwen Verdon, Cheetah Rivera, and Jerry Orbach, directed by Bob Fosse, now at the 46th Street Theater.
And so Gwen Verdon, her husband, he had won for Cabaret, Bob Fosse. He directed it. And then he had some health issues, cocaine, heart attack and a lot of smoking.
As one does.
As one does. He's a whole other story. We talked about it much more when we were talking about Cameron.
He's a lifestyle.
He really is. Did you ever see the Fosse show on Broadway when they had Fosse?
Yes.
It was great.
Yeah. It was really good.
That was really
good. With Anne Reinking.
Yes. So we're going into the 1975 version. They updated. They have songs. I mean, this is Frank Ebb and John Kander. This is probably one of my favorite musicals. It's in my top five. These songs are incredible.
It's awfully good.
They're really catchy. They move the story along. It's the dancing is sexy and it's thrilling. Gwen Verdon is in her 40s at this point, and Cheetah Rivera plays Velma.
Come on.
The name of a sensational musical group that keeps turning out hit records. And for another, it's the name of a smash Broadway musical still playing to capacity audiences after a year on Broadway. And you're about to see two reasons why they're packing them in at the 46th Street Theater. Here are Cheetah Rivera and Gwen Verdon. Welcome them, please.
It's good, isn't it grand, isn't it great, isn't it swell, isn't it fun, isn't it nowadays? You can like the life you're living, you can live the life you like, you can even marry Harry. But mess around with Ike, and that's good. Isn't it grand? Isn't it great? Isn't it swell? Isn't it fun? Isn't it? But nothing stays. In 50 years or so, it's gonna change, you know. But oh, it's heaven nowadays.
Cheetah Rivera.
And Jerry Orbach is Billy Flynn. This show was so popular.
It's outstanding.
It's so good. And it's like, for me, like, I grew up with Jerry Orbach being Law and Order, the Law and Order guy, Lenny Briscoe. Like, that's what I watched for years. He was a song and dance man. He could really sing. He could really dance. So the show goes out. And then I think, does Gwen get sick or something happens with Gwen and she has to postpone performances? So Liza Minnelli goes in and subs for her for a couple of weeks. And everybody, and it's 1975, Liza Minnelli. Everyone's going to see Liza. I mean, I would.
Peak Liza.
Peak LM. So she does the show. And a lot of critics at first gave this production a hard time for being cynical, of all things. New York City in the 1970s.
I mean, can't we just have a nice show about two murderers that go free? Can't we have that?
You know, it's themes about the media, what's going on in the media and all that stuff. So Liza goes in. The demand for the tickets goes through the roof. And then this show does very, very well. It happens to go up at the same time as a little show called A Chorus Line when it comes to the Tony Award nominations. And they were all nominated for all the awards. And it's just a year. And look, A Chorus Line's a great show.
Fosse versus Hamlish.
Hamlish is great writing, a great writer.
It is.
It's a really good show. I've seen that one too a few times. It does great. I mean, so the shows are really
sick. Although I'm going to say it.
Yeah.
Chicago holds up better.
Oh, well, okay. So the movie of A Chorus Line is dreadful.
Agreed.
I've seen an update of it a few years ago. It was okay, but it's very 70s. It's very much a product of his time, whereas Chicago is just incredible.
Everybody here. Is everybody ready? I don't care about expensive things. Cashmere coats, diamond rings don't mean a thing. All I care about is love. That's what I'm here for. I don't care for wearing silk cravats, ruby studs, satin spats don't mean a thing. All I care about is love.
All I care about is love.
Give me two eyes of blue, softly saying, I need you. Let me see her standing there, and honest mister, I'm a millionaire. I don't care for any fine attire Vanderbilt might admire. No, no, not me. All I care about is love.
All he cares about is love.
1996, 97, it's on Broadway again. Bebe Neuwirth is our Velma. Anne Reinking, who was Bob Fosse's lover and protege, she's now choreographing the show. And it went from these little pasties and little, you know, lingerie to black outfits. And it became this, and it's sleek and it's sexy. And I saw it with Bebe Neuwirth and at that time.
And oh, wow.
It was so good. It was so, so good. And it was, and people just kind of had Chicago mania. It's been playing in New York ever since.
Yeah.
It's, you could, you know, people. Yep.
How about that, Maureen?
Yeah. It still holds up. Let's go to the 2002 film. So that's what we're really comparing today, because we can't go into a time machine and see 70s version. So here, let's play the trailer first. And I love this trailer because they actually put narration on it, like, in a world where.
A flash of leg. The taste of temptation. The smell of corruption. Things that go bump in the night.
Slick your hair, wear your buckle shoes, and all that jazz.
Velma has it.
When a brand new start to do that jazz.
Roxy wants it.
All my life I wanted to have my own act.
That's great. I'll be in touch.
You know, I'm not quite finished yet.
Face it, Roxy. You ain't never gonna have an act.
You got connections.
I would have said anything to get a piece of that.
What you need is Billy Flynn.
He's never lost a case.
Billy can fix it.
My client feels that it was the combination of liquor and jazz which led to her downfall.
Hey, Mama.
You're the Velma Kelly. I was there the night that you got arrested.
Yeah, you and half of Chicago. You couldn't buy that kind of publicity.
But in a city where everyone loves a legend, there's only room for one.
You want some advice? Keep your paws off my lawyer.
Sweetest little jazz killer ever to hit Chicago.
That's the angle I'm after.
You were in the paper today, too. In the back, with the obituaries. They love me.
They might be a lot more if you're a hang. You know why? Because they sell more papers.
That's Chicago.
Catherine Zeta-Jones. Renee Zellweger. And Richard Gere.
Are you guilty or not guilty?
Don't you want to take my picture?
Good night, folks.
That jazz.
Chicago.
Rob Marshall is our director. This is a Miramax production.
I know.
They're
now dumb. Whenever you see that, like, that come into focus, the Miramax thing, you're just like, ugh,
great. Kind of besmirches
all
it.
All right.
Whatever. Renee Zellweger is our Roxy. I think she's great. I think she's...
This movie is so well cast.
Oh, my God. Oh,
It's so well cast.
We have Catherine Zeta-Jones, who's fabulous as Velma. I mean, and they both look great in their bob haircuts. And
They're
sexy.
All day long.
All day long.
All day long.
We're just going to be...
Catherine and Renee.
Oh, please. And then Richard Gere, who had never tap danced before, was not known to be a song and dance man, just took lessons for the movie and does a great job as our Billy Flynn. We also have Queen Latifah, When You're Good to Mama.
She's fantastic.
Yes.
She's great. This was Living, like a little bit after that, right?
Yeah.
Single.
Yeah. I was working on her talk show.
Really? I liked her talk show. Yeah. I thought it was good. She's good at that.
Yeah. It was nutty. She was competing with the Ricky Lake. It was filmed in the same buildings. I'll tell you those stories some other time.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the keeper of the keys, the countess of the clink, the mistress of Murderer's Row, Matron Mama Morton.
Ask any of the chickies in my pen. They'll tell you I'm the biggest mother hen. I love them all and all of them love me. Because the system works, the system called reciprocity. Welcome, ladies. Got a little motto, always sees me through. When you're good to mama, mama's good to you.
You might think I'm here to make your life a living hell. It's just not true.
There's a lot of favors I'm prepared to do. You do one for mama, she'll do one for you.
Like me a friend if you let me.
This cast, it's like Dominic West, Taye Diggs, John C. Reilly, who's incredible. Christine Baranski as Mary Sunshine. I mean, she is just, I mean, this is Lucy Liu. And we have Maya.
Yeah.
As one of the murderers row. It's just, I don't know what to say, except this is just, it's a brilliant movie. It's not filmed very much in Chicago. I think most of it's on a set.
Yeah, which is fine.
It's fine.
You know, it definitely lends itself to... I mean, the thing about this show that's so exciting and brilliant and similar in a similar vein along the lines of Cabaret. So obviously they had, experience doing this sort of thing. But what's so fun about the show is that it doesn't pretend to be... It's our kind of 20th century, 21st century idealization of the jazz age, mm-hmm. And the jazz babies and da-da-da and lights. But it's not really trying like, Model Ford is incorrect. You're not going to get bogged down in that so much. But I like that the stage play gives you none of that, but I like that the film gives you some little flashes of that, mm-hmm. of, they're in costume, but now we're actually in our prison uniforms and going back and forth. I really liked that device of, every now and again, kind of grounding it into reality, which I think, and I can understand. I can understand Maureen's relationship to her material and that work and feeling, I would feel that way. I would feel like, I was trying to make a buck. I was trying to make a name for myself as a writer.
Right.
And oh man, I helped get two murderers.
I was young.
Who really probably needed to face justice.
Yeah. I was young. I was learning how to write. This was all new to mm-hmm. me. This was exciting. And I fell for this.
And so, her play, we should say, and we'll talk about this in a minute. Her play does sort of attempt to show you that, mm-hmm. How twisted that is. Because all of those characters are in her play. Mary Sunshine's there. Everybody's there. And so I can understand that when, like, Mr. Bob Fosse comes knocking at your door and like, hey, I want to make, I can understand her being like, yeah, I don't think I want to, I trust you with that. I couldn't trust myself with that. And I don't know that I trust you, Mr. Fosse. So no. So I get it. But I think just like you were saying, like how the in the 70s, how progressive this was and how people felt it was too cynical in terms of its portrayal of the media, it was not any more cynical than hers was.
Right.
And I feel like the Fosse Verdon version really delivers on what Maurine would have wanted. Don't you?
Oh, absolutely. I think because she is saying that it's the cult of personality that they're selling, and that's what people are selling. And by the way, that's what they're selling in a jury box. That's like what you're selling is that's
totally.
It's totally what it is. I think in the play, from what I read, I think Roxy doesn't feel very guilty about what she's done.
She doesn't at all.
She doesn't.
In the play, she never does in the musical either.
Right.
But she really, you know, we're introduced to Roxy. First of all, we see the first is like a little prologue scene where she kills the guy. So you know she killed him.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about it whatsoever, which I think is a really nice setup that Watson did for us. So we are never under any illusion that, well, maybe, you know, she's awfully pretty. And you're never, you saw her kill that guy. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, when she's interacting with the other murderesses on Murderess Row, you therefore kind of jump to the conclusion, right or wrong, that they did it too.
Right.
And Velma too
is
like,
coming.
Yeah, he had it coming. A lot of the stuff that's in the play, all the versions, is lifted again right from her journalism. So even the dialogue, even, you know, some of the lines that those women actually said or that she wrote that they actually said,
mm-hmm.
They may or may not have actually said them because she was such a good writer, but they are in all of the versions and they are so strong that they, you know, they are still there today. And, but things like we both reach for the gun,
mm-hmm.
that's from the real case. Things like, my baby, that's yep. from the real case. So all of these things that seem like such brilliant plot devices are real things that these criminals really did to get off scot-free, which is what happened. But the big difference between the original play and the musical is the end. In the original play, it ends with, it's a similar ending, but the musical goes further. In the play, Roxy is let off. Mm-hmm. She's going scot-free. And we don't know if Velma's free or not, I don't think.
No,
right?
She doesn't have a trial.
And yeah, she never even has her trial. And so Roxy is pronounced innocent and she's thinking, yay, now I get to begin my career in vaudeville. Ha-cha. And as she's walking out of the courtroom, all of the reporters leave her. They just abandon her. They drop her like a hot rock because there's a bang, bang off stage and some new jazz baby has killed somebody.
Right.
And so she's yesterday's news, sister, which is a great ending. And it, again, it makes all the statements that we're familiar with as far as this play. But I really love that, again, that the musical just takes that and just turns it all the way up to 11 and really makes sure that we understand that everything old is new again.
Well, what happened with Maurine Watkins, I think this is the Maurine Watkins episode, is as she did the job for 8 months and then she wanted to go back to school. But as soon as she left, Leopold and Loeb were on trial. And that's one of the most famous trials ever.
Indeed.
Yeah, that was considered a crime of the century until Lindbergh's baby was kidnapped. In the movie, so Renee Zellweger is with Dominic West. He's so sexy. He's such a rogue. And she shoots him. And you think, like, Roxy's probably not all there. Roxy's got kind of a issue. But
yeah.
Yeah. Roxy's not all completely there. She gets, I love this. She gets to the prison and she, of course, she's gobsmacked when she meets Catherine Zeta-Jones. She thinks Velma's amazing. She's been reading about her in the papers. She's her biggest fan.
She also eats all this stuff up in the newspapers. Yeah.
Yeah. She thinks this is great. Like, this is going to be great for my career. I'm going to have a career now. And Velma is sort of like, yeah, whatever. When Renee Zellweger gets Billy Flynn by Richard Gere, it's $5,000 that it costs, and that's the equivalent to $70,000 today. It's an enormous amount of money.
That's a great amount of money for a car mechanic.
For a car mechanic, John C. Reilly. And I never really liked the song Mr. Cellophane, but he does it very well.
Neither, but I love his version of it. Yep, agreed.
He makes it pathetic. Like, he really just, you really feel for the man. So he has to get her out of there. And Queen Latifah is Mama Morton, the matron. It's just such great casting because her voice is just fantastic. And I love it that she's Team Velma. And then she kind of gets caught up in Roxy's sort of star power. And there's one scene where she, all of a sudden she has the blonde hair. That's such a great...
It's so cute.
It's so great. It's such a great joke.
Oh, and we should say, yeah, that there's... So this was another... it's the Maureen show. This was another thing that Maureen experienced when she was working the Murderess Row beat, was that, you know, there were a lot of women who were in prison for... as there are today, for not necessarily killing a man in cold blood and not being remorseful, but they're killing abusive...
Oh, yeah, domestic,
you know,
violence.
Boyfriends. And, you know, there's a lot of... And there was one woman in particular, and I think those articles are in this book too, if I remember, who was... I think she was Italian, not Hungarian, but in the play, she's Hungarian.
Mm-hmm.
And she... she's either completely innocent or she was totally doing it in self-defense that she accidentally killed this man. But because she's a quote unquote foreigner,
mm-hmm.
and I'm talking about in real life, Maureen's editor was like, I don't care about them. Give me the jazz babies, you know? So, it was partly because they were white, you know, partly because they mm-hmm. were not foreign
and they were
pretty. And so, you know, justice was very, again, a cult of personality. So I love that is in the play. It's in the original play, and it is in the it's in the musical as well. That the, you know, the poor little Hungarian woman in the play hangs.
Yeah,
yeah.
We have that in the movie too, but they just allude to it really quickly.
I like the way they did it. Yeah, they did a good job, I thought.
Yeah, I super love Richard Gere. You know, I could take him or leave him sometimes in a movie.
Me too, but I think he's good in this.
He's fantastic. He's a perfect Billy Flynn. And I love the scene they did where they reach for the gun and it's the marionettes with the strings.
I bet you want to know why I shot the bastard.
Shut up, dummy.
Mr. Billy Flynn in the press conference, right? Notice how his mouth never moves. Almost.
Where'd you come from?
Mississippi.
And your parents?
Very wealthy.
Where are they now?
6 feet under.
But she was granted one more start.
The convent of the Sacred Heart.
When'd you get here?
1920.
How old were you?
Don't remember.
Then what happened?
I met Amos and he stole my heart. Convince me to elope one day.
Oh, poor dear, I can't believe what you've been through. A convent girl, a runaway marriage. Now tell us, Roxy, who's Rick Hastley?
My ex-boyfriend.
Why'd you shoot him?
People always say, like, oh, Roxy's the easier part because she's just sort of going along. I'm like, no, it's not. I mean, she's...
Yeah, that looks really hard.
It's very challenging.
That scene in particular seems super hard. Yeah.
And Christine Baranski was on Broadway, too. She's a Broadway baby, and she just does a really excellent job of it. They talk about the media. They talk about how she becomes... And then Roxy gets a big ego... And the Velma wants to partner up with her, and Roxy just gives her the raspberry, like, go away. I'm a big star now. Roxy gets her case. Roxy pretends to be pregnant. Roxy wins the case. Oh, spoilers here. And then in the end, she tells her sweet husband, who, what did he have to do to raise $5,000? Who knows? But that she's going on the road, you know, bye. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for the $5,000. Stupid.
Dummy.
Bye.
Bye. And she, at the end, she and Catherine Zeta-Jones do this incredible dance routine. Catherine Zeta-Jones, let me tell you, how much work she does in this thing. She deserves that Oscar. She got an Oscar for that performance.
And danced her head off.
Oh, and singing and doing and stunts. Singing.
Yep.
It's spectacular. It makes $300 million. It's nominated for a whole bunch of Oscars. It wins for Best Picture, which hadn't been for a musical in decades up to that point. And I have to say, it's 20 years. It's 20 years. Can you believe it? It's been 20 years since it came out.
I cannot believe it.
Did you see it in New York?
It really holds up. I think I did see it in New York.
Yeah. I saw it at the Ziegfeld.
I think it's awesome. I think it really, really holds up. Interestingly, again, very similar to our playwright, our source playwright last week. I was looking when Chicago, the original, you know, Fosse Verdon production came out, Maurine does not get a writer's credit in the nomination when so much of the dialogue is hers and the story is hers and the directions, stage directions even are exactly the same. Yep. And nope.
Yeah. Zippo. And it does extremely well. And it's a classic. It's held up. It was released, I believe, at Christmas time. If memory serves, and I super love it. I can't honestly decide which I like more.
I know. If you can get your hands on this play, I know I'm afraid that the silent movie just doesn't cut it. It's the play is so good and so well written. And the dialogue, again, probably any dialogue that you love from this musical is from the original play. The dialogue is amazing. She really has a way with, you know, back and forth, you know, dialogue. Very similar. It reminded me a little bit of the one with Rosalind Russell.
Is it Friday?
Yes, yes. It reminded me a bit of that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, if you can get your hands on it, please, you will love reading this play. It's really fun. But this musical, and especially this movie version of it, it's awfully good. I mean, I think it says so much that, first of all, you can watch all we have available to us in terms of the original Broadway production are, you know, these television appearances that happen and the performances at the Tonys and all that, which, albeit very cleaned up for television, still so racy.
It's very racy.
And that you can watch that in, you know, in the 21st century and be like, dang, look at them. The dancing, you know, the Fosse, like the direct to Fosse dancing that's going on. And then see this later version, this 21st century version, and to see how the message, Maureen's message, completely holds up. Mm-hmm. It still feels fresh. It still feels exciting. You know, how many times have I seen this thing? I've seen it a zillion, squillion times. I think we did a production of it when I was in college. So, I've probably seen this like 60 times way or another.
Yeah.
And I still freaking love it. Like, I don't know what's going to happen next. I know what's going to happen, but I don't care. I'm thinking maybe this time there is a baby.
It's the songs, I think, though. I mean,
The
songs are so good. One after the other. Nowadays, at the end, I love the Mike Douglas Show clip that I put in there, and it's Cheetah
with
Rivera
with Gwen and Cheetah
in their mid 40s, dancing their asses off, and then
slaying it.
And then just giving interviews like, yeah, and they were great friends. They were really great friends. It's, yeah.
You can tell their chemistry is so good.
The show. So if you get a chance to see the show, I say go see it. I might see it with Pamela Anderson, to be honest with you. I'm kind of curious.
You know, I'm kind of into it with Pamela Anderson. I think that's going to be good.
We should go.
That would be fun.
That would be fun. We can get a group together. Any book versus movie people in New York want to meet up. All right. I can't decide. I just can't decide. I love it all.
No, I want to say it's a tie.
Yeah.
And I so enjoyed learning about this playwright. I knew nothing about her. I had seen The Drunk History.
Yes. I was just going to mention Drunk History.
Which is surprisingly good and informative, I should say. I mean, like, I love that.
Mae Whitman?
Whoever writes the drunk histories that the comedians have to study does such a bang up job. Like, they really get the main points in there. So I'd seen that. So I knew a little bit about her, but I didn't know, you know, I certainly didn't know about her later career or, you know, any of that. A really fascinating person. Yet again.
Yeah.
I didn't think we could top last week. You know, it's at least a tie.
Yeah.
These two. I'm sure they're just living it up in heaven right now.
Isn't that nice to think about?
So, let's talk about what we're doing next. I'm very excited for this next one.
It's going to be, so Harry Belafonte, still with us, 95 years old. We were talking about him, and Carmen Jones is the movie, Dorothy Dandridge, Harry Belafonte. It's an opera. It's beautiful. And it's based on a story, Prosper Mérimée, Carmen Other Stories. It's a short story. You could get it on the Libby app. It's like 20 pages. It's really quick. I haven't read it before.
I read it in high school, I think.
Yeah.
I've read it before, but it's been a while, so I'm going to read it again.
And I haven't seen Carmen Jones in forever.
So, me either.
Super excited to get that. So that's Prosper Mérimée, Carmen, or just watch the movie Carmen Jones. And then we're going to pick one more, but we're not quite sure. So what we might do in the Facebook group is put up a poll and have like a few ideas, and then you help us pick out the one we're going to finish with. And I just love musicals in March. It's like my favorite.
It's so much fun. I really enjoy it. I'm not a big musical person, you know, generally, but I love doing these episodes. We just learned so much.
I know.
And some of these, and I know, like, okay, it's interesting to examine like a stage play to a movie. Like, for instance, you know, Oklahoma, mm-hmm. like we talked about last week, breathtaking movie. Like, none of that stuff. You're not going to see actual corn, you know, actual horses necessarily in a stage production of Oklahoma. But this, and the same thing like with this movie where they were going back and forth from like the scantily clad dancers to I'm in the courtroom in my prison, you know, mm-hmm. garb. It's great. It's great.
Yeah. It's been really fun. So that's coming up next time. Please follow us on all the places social media wise. Once again, our email is bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. Also, let us know if you would be interested in a Patreon yearly, just a one-time, boom, pay for it and forget about it for a year kind of thing. We can make that happen, and we'll do it for starting April 1st. And Margo, where can they find you?
You can find me online at coloniabook.com, and all of my social media callouts are at She's Not Your Mama. And where can they find you?
You can find me on social media at Brooklyn Fitchick, mostly for Twitter and Instagram. My site is brooklynfitchick.com. All right, but everybody, in the meantime, we're going to razzle-dazzle them as
dun,
we go.
Dun, 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 da, da, da,
da. Thank you so much for listening to the Book Versus Movie podcast. We are a part of the Frolic Podcast Network. You can find more podcasts you will love at frolic.media/podcasts. We follow the hashtags LadyPodSquad and PodernFamily. If you want to support the show, you can go to our Patreon page. Go to PATREON and look for Book Versus Movie Podcast. We have a basic Facebook page, but we also have a private Facebook group. Go to Facebook and type in Book VS Movie Podcast Group if you want to join that. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Book Versus Movie. Spell all those words out. If you'd like to send us an email, it's Book Versus Movie Podcast, spelled it all out, at gmail.com. You can follow Margo D at Brooklyn Fit Chick on social media, and Margo P at She's Nacho Mama. Thanks so much again for checking out our show, and we'll be back soon with a new episode. From just